All right, now the best way to begin is to simply start, get going, get the ball rolling. Welcome to all the viewers of this video. We will try and make this as profound as possible. We will cover a lot of territory here. And so there's a reason that I have this picture as a background, because I'll be referring to it from time to time. On the left, you see the great spiritual touchstone, Sri Anandamayi Ma, and on the right, you see her husband, Sri Bolanath, who was a spiritual disciple. He was not a guru in his own right. Okay, in this video, we are going to take a look at what I call idolatry, because idolatry marks the spirit of these times. If you ask what kind of world do we live in now, we live in an idolatrous world. Very, very, very severe. Getting worse all the time. And it's an extraordinarily dangerous situation. Okay. So, we will lay this out in the video. And I've decided to keep on making videos as long as there is, you know, viewers. It doesn't slip down into no views at all, which will be discouraging, but as long as there's viewers and getting some positive feedback, I will try to do my best, because I'm able to shed light on deep matters that others won't get into, because if one is interested in idolatry and being idolized, they will not speak the truth, the clear truth. At this time in the world, even the spiritual teachers of the times are receiving a tremendous amount of idolatry. And most of the reactions to them are idolatrous. In other words, instead of, well, there's an example, like my attitude towards Sri Anandamayi Ma, which is one of my spiritual mentors, is very respectful. But I'm interested in the truth. I'm interested in what she's pointing to. Not interested in her, not interested in her persona, her personality. And it's great, but that is really very far down the list. You know, I used to be very taken with the persona, the spiritual charisma. But I found out that that's actually very troublesome and dangerous thing. And I'll give you a cautionary tale here. That's a severe one. Now, as a way of entry into this, I will say that you know, this, as I said, it's 5:44 May 15, 2012, and I'm taping this right after work, getting to it before the mosquitoes chew me up. And I have to work hard because I have to pay bills, and I have a lot of bills to pay because I spent a lot of money on credit. Okay, there's a reason why I did that. Because I was actually deceived. I was misled, severely misled. And you wonder, how could I be misled? I wondered the same thing, because I thought I really had a very clear understanding of things, but it wasn't clear enough. It wasn't clear enough. Because I was tricked in a very, very clever way, in a way that anybody would fall victim to. There are some profoundly clever entities and intelligences at work in the psychic realm, who are able to deceive even those who have a tremendous amount of clarity. It's still possible. And idolatry is one of those things that can be used for this purpose. So what happened to me was I came across Anandamayi Ma and saw that she was perfectly awake and perfectly established in true identity, flawlessly established. And it was very clear. As I said, this teacher is flawless, which is true. Very rare. But what happened was beings, entities in the psychic realm, in the subtle psychic realm, what they can do and do actually employ is they can create a psychic hologram of great spiritual teachers, whether it be Jesus, Anandamayi Ma, Ramana Maharshi, whatever, any great spiritual teacher in this world. they create a psychic hologram, and then they send this psychic hologram into your psyche telepathically. And you believe, you think that it is the actual guru that is contacting you, okay? And they did that with me using Anandamayi, a hologram of Anandamayi. So I thought it was her that was actually contacting me. And then, so I believe what was being told to me telepathically. And what I was told was that there was going to be a great spiritual revival in the world. I was told that there's a great, tremendous amount of problems in the world, which is true. So I said, yes, this is very true. And then all these problems are pointed out, and those were also true. And then I was told that someone like Anandamayi was going to come back in the world and make themselves known. They were to come out to the world, and that they needed a support staff for this. And I was asked if I would like to participate in this. So everything seemed extremely plausible. Because yes, the world is in a horrible situation, very, very dark, idolatrous situation right now. And there's an extreme need for a spiritual revival. There's extreme need for a teacher that can be a very, very clear and powerful touchstone for us, as Anandamayi was. And she was here, a tremendous touchstone for many, because people look at her and see the perfect vision of oneness. That she was in this complete, she saw only the one, only oneness, that's nothing other than that. And then they could say, okay, this is it, and then judge other stuff and say, well, this other stuff isn't up to this level, so there must be trying some sort of compromise, so that's not it. So very valuable that was touched on, and I realized this, saw it very clearly, knew all of this very clearly. So I said, yeah, this is exactly what the world needs, is for some really tremendous spiritual presence to come into the world. So when I was told this is going to happen, and that I my whole life I've been preparing for this to happen, which is very true, I believed it would happen, that I was told yes, it's going to happen, and I could participate and help this grow and expand in the world. So I said, okay, sure, I'm in. But with reservations, I said, you know, I've got to see the right kind of feedback. So I went along and I began doing all sorts of preparations for this and spending enormous amounts of money that I didn't even have. Each time I did this, I checked in and said, well, I gotta be paid back right away because I cannot carry this debt. And I was assured that I'd be paid back. And so this went on and on and on. And each time I would spend and do tremendous efforts and works, sparing no expense or effort on my part. It was all in. I was given all these very, very great reassurances that, you know, if I just did this one more thing, it would all begin. And if I didn't, I was holding the whole thing up. And it was a guilt trip. And the way I was led down the primrose path was so artful and incredibly plausible that even though I had severe reservations, I still said, well, I it's worth the risk, you know. It's not like I said, this is not risky. I said, it's worth the risk because it seems like it's very plausible this will happen. And I want to do everything that I can do to help the world, help all of you have a touchstone. It's supremely important. Well, long story short, I never got paid back a penny. Nothing ever happened. I got left up a creek without a paddle, holding the entire burden on my own shoulders with not a shred of help. And so I was completely duped, as you might say, swindled. And it's put me in a terrible financial situation for my life, ruined my life financially. And no help whatsoever, you know, just stranded, so to speak. I said, and during this time, I was double checking all of this just to make sure what's going on. And I came across someone, I think they were in Denver, Colorado, I've got a website. And they talked about how the reptilian aliens create these holograms of spiritual gurus and mislead people, high disciples in this world, and it was able to deceive them. And I said, my gosh, that's exactly what happened to me. And I had felt this as a possibility, but in my case, I felt I really had double-checked it. Amazing miracles took place, but I tell you this, the psychic world is able to generate miracles in this world. guidance. They're able to generate guidance. So I had enormous guidance. I could wake up in the morning and be told to go to a specific place I've never been before. I had no idea about that it existed. I would just drive somewhere and then be told, go to this place, this store, in this store, a specific item you need to purchase. And the exact item would be in there. It was just amazing. Almost complete miraculous guidance every day to find things and purchase things and to set up a very elaborate situation, like a massive satsang. I really did all the groundwork to set up a profound, massive satsang. And the whole thing was based on the premise that a great teacher would arise in this world. And I was told they're already here, but they're young and they're not able to function as a teacher yet, but they will soon be capable of doing that. That's the cover story I was told. So I said, okay. And double checked it, triple checked it, checked it every day, and kept getting many, many miracles that pointed in this direction. Once again, long story short, nothing ever happened. Absolutely nothing. Zero. So it was all a fabrication, a wild goose chase designed to basically ruin me and drive me into destitution, which, you know, it almost did. I mean, ultimately the goal was to drive me into suicide. That was their plan. That didn't work. It hasn't worked yet, and hopefully it will not work. But these entities, these psychic entities, that this man who had a website called the Reptilians, and certainly that can be very true, they are extremely wicked. You have to call them extremely wicked. Let's call them extremely ignorant, enmeshed in extreme forgetfulness of what they are. I don't like using terms like wickedness and evil, etc., because that's an emotional term. What we want is a reason-based term that helps us see clearly. Term I use is steeped in deep forgetfulness of what they are, enmeshed in severe forgetfulness of what they are. What they are is spirit, just like I am spirit, you are spirit. God created us as spirit in truth. That's what we are. We're not bodies, we're not person, we're not male, we're not female, we're not human, we're not reptilian, we're not any of that. All of that is simply a fantasy being generated by the mind to steep us in deep forgetfulness of what we are. So I came here to try and help lift the world out of that deep forgetfulness. And so I was so altruistic and compassionate. I was willing to buy into the notion that there would be help, great help for this world. A spiritual revival that you can believe there'd be a tremendous spiritual revival taking place, completely planned for that my entire life. I was 100% wrapped around that belief that it would happen. Well, the fact is, it didn't happen. Hasn't happened, didn't happen. It was all a mirage. So, these entities, reptilian entities, what they want is idolatry. That's what they're after. Why? Because they want to be worshipped. But the real purpose of me trying to promote this tremendous spiritual revival that was taking place was actually very clever. They were trying to get me to promote idolizing spiritual gurus, and they chose Ananda Maima because they felt that many people would idolize her, especially because she's was female. And during these times, there's been a massive, how would you put it? I have to think exactly how to put this without getting into emotionalism. Let us say that the females of this planet, the female energy, has been severely utilized, duped by the reptilians, really severely misused, used in the direction of idolatry. And the world has been trained to once again look at females, at goddesses, at glamorous women, etc., and to idolize them. It's a way to get into idolatry. Because you look at the man on there on the right, the tribal one, he doesn't cut his hair, his beard, doesn't groom himself, you know, he's very unglamorous. He's not someone that anybody would idolize. You see, but you see a Trinana Maima on the left, and she has this incredible mysteriousness about her, you know, which is because she is only seeing the one. That's all she sees is the one. So it's genuine spiritual charisma there. And yet it's very easy for the world to get, transfer that feeling onto some other female figure or figures and start idolizing them, thinking that they have some great spirituality about them, when in fact, all that's taking place is idolatry. Okay. See, Ananda Maimon was profoundly uninterested in being idolized. She was a supreme indifference to how anyone felt about her. And that was conveyed to those who spent the most time around her. They said, you know, she's so remote, completely remote, and they could not idolize her because of her attitude. But if you promote promotion of female figures as being, you know, great goddesses and supremely wise and powerful, etc., that feeds into a mood, it cultivates a mood of idolatry in the world. So that was the real purpose of the reptilians, creating this holographic, a psychic, a hologram, and projecting it telepathically and using that to deceive me, was to get me to work in a direction which would actually help foster idolatry in the world. So bit by bit by bit, I got wise to it. You know, I said, something's drastically wrong here. You know, it's very strange. And I wonder, how could an Ananda Maimon allow such a thing to take place? Well, here's a corollary to that in A Course in Miracles, which I believe was telepathically shared with the world by Jesus. But whoever it was, even if it wasn't, very wise being, very helpful, very wise, very awake being, shared that with the world. And in this sharing, this being who says that they are Jesus Christ, they said that they lamented many times, severe lamenting about the bitter, bitter idols that the world has made of Jesus. In other words, it's Jesus lamenting the severe idolatry that has been that he has been used for. Now I would say to him, what did you expect? Of course. So if Jesus can't stop his presence in this world being turned into idolatrous purposes, Ananda Maimon cannot stop it either. So apparently these great touchstones of perfect remembrance of what we are, they cannot prevent their personas, their historic record that they leave, they cannot prevent that from being utilized by deception. They cannot. Now, when I first became profoundly aware of Sri Ananda Maimon on the inner plane, I also became aware of another figure that was trying to imitate her, deceive her, that was trying to look like her, act like her, that was pretending to be her. And I saw that this was a very wicked god woman, very wicked goddess, feminine figure. And it's this feminine figure that was basically impersonating her, as a psychic impersonation. Very, very well done too, I have to say. And utilizing many, many, many tricks and deceptions and weaknesses, okay, within my own persona, exploiting it to the max. So you could say this is, you know, the action is extremely oriented towards forgetfulness, which many would say is evil or wickedness or deception. It's oriented towards idolatry and forgetfulness of what we are. So I have made it a purpose to undo whatever I did that wasn't helpful. Fortunately, I was very ineffective in what I did. Very, very ineffective, which is a great thing. But I lost my shirt, I embarrassed myself, and I made promises to people I couldn't keep. It was just, you know, it was a really horrible thing. And all in the name of thought I was promoting Ananda Maimon, see, but I wasn't. Not really. I was really promoting idolatry. So, like I said, I made it a point now to undo that and make amends for that and try to, a thousand times over, bring clarity to the situation and warn people, cautionary tale, about the tremendous dangers of idolatry in this world. Now, I've looked at a lot of other gurus and teachers. I'm keen on this. I'm very keen on noticing idolatry now. And I'm very aware relating to a spiritual teacher in an idolatrous way, which will severe exploitation by darkness, by forgetfulness of what we are. Idolatry leads to superficial, it fits the ego's agenda to a T. Okay, we even have a president right now who is feeding the idolatrous nature of the times severely. Okay, fits the times perfectly, but the times are idolatrous times, and it creates a cult of personality. So not only do we have political leaders feeding that, we have spiritual leaders who, even though they may not want it, they're getting it, it's a lot of it. Most of the people that come to these spiritual teachers have an idolatrous type of focus. And what I get, what I see, I observe very carefully, I see a lot. It is that the people, the devotees come and they're in love with the teacher. They're not in love with the teaching, they're in love with the teacher. And they think the teacher is the greatest being in the world, that they're just so totally fantastic. And they have this great personal love of the teacher. And they're in this state of profound idolatry of this teacher. And when one does that, one is not capable of really seeing the truth, not choosing the truth. For instance, now in A Course in Miracles, which I believe it was a non-idolatrous teaching, it says the whole purpose of this teaching is to get to the point where you can completely set down the teaching and not even need it anymore. Reject, you know, just say, I'm finished with it. I have no interest in it. I have no more interest in words at all. Even. Go beyond it, transcend it. The whole purpose is to transcend it. Same thing with Ananda Maima. Her whole purpose wasn't to have worship of her. Her purpose was to generate a spiritual work ethic in all her devotees, which she has done with me. Successful in that is, and because if you don't have a spiritual work ethic, you'll never succeed. Guaranteed. The only way to succeed is to generate a strong, strong spiritual work ethic. And you say, well, what about the people who got lucky, like Ramana Maharshi, who woke up at 16 or something, didn't seem to work at it at all? Well, guaranteed that he had done vast amounts of work previously, or was simply an avatar who had no karma, no forgetfulness in the first place. That could have been true also. And just, it was just his, he just laid low for a while and then came out when he was 16. And my mom didn't really come out to the world until she was, again, around, you know, 18, 19, something like that. Laid low. But was born an avatar, had no karma at all. No karma means forgetfulness. That's a better word to use than karma. Forgetfulness of what we are. She had zero. Never had any. So never had to work off any. Never had to awake. Was always, never chose to forget what she is, spirit. Never chose that. So had no, was awake from before birth. Never been asleep and never been in forgetfulness. So that's a great touchstone. Very helpful thing. Now, idolatry is incapable of adapting the type of work ethic. What they try to do, idolatry, is try to think that the guru can solve their problems for them. That if they just love the guru enough, the guru will fix the problems of this world for them somehow. Will make this world a perfect place. You know, it's kind of like as if you worship a leader so much, you think that if you give all your energy to the leader in worship, that the leader then has the capability to do miracles. You empower them. It's sort of like an attempt to empower someone that you believe will use this empowerment in your best interests. Okay, that's idolatry. It's thinking that someone has something that you don't and may never have, and yet they can give you some of what they have. And this is the ego's religion. Idolatry is the religion of the ego. And every single being that comes over, even Jesus, the ego can use them for idolatrous purposes. Okay, the ego will build an idolatrous religion around them, as the ego has done with Jesus, and as the ego will do with anyone that teaches in this world. The ego is able to spin an idolatrous religion around them, and many, many people will buy into that. Eventually, that leads to abandoning all religion and turning to secular idols, which is what we're doing right now, which I said previously, not to be political, because there's a spiritual discussion, but the president of the U.S. is an idolatrous figure. He accepts idolatry. He does not condemn it or criticize it. When those people respond to him in an idolatrous way, he doesn't say anything about it or even encourages it, whereas a non-idolatrous being would severely condemn that and say, that is not it. Don't put me on that pedestal, not at all. This is, turn towards, if you want someone on a pedestal, turn towards a perfect teacher, to a perfect guru. So if you want to, if you have idolatrous tendencies, then use them, turn to a great guru, a great teacher. Okay, and then they can eventually, what they'll do is they'll put you on a path of tremendous spiritual effort and work, and you'll be so bogged down in that you won't really have time to be so idolatrous. But in these days and at times, it seems as though the balance is tipping in the favor of idolatry, and it concerns me a great deal. Because it's an extraordinarily wicked thing. It's a path of forgetfulness of what we are. But we are a spirit. We're not people. We're not personas. We're not physical beings. We're not physical. We're not having experience here in this world. This world is not an experience of what we are. It's a dream of forgetfulness of what we are. And the only way out of that is a dream of remembrance of what we are. And this dream of remembrance, I call it overlay. Some different term called awareness, oneness, seem to be. Okay, we got some back. Great. When people watch television, they're participating in idolatry. Okay? Guaranteed. When you're seeing those stars up there, those actors, those actresses, they're so glorious, beautiful, and you're thinking, people are thinking that they're trying to figure out, how can I be like this? How can I get my appearance to be like this? And they think that this person can give them the answer. But again, a spiritual teacher will tell you the only answer is for you to choose a new idea. And this effect of this new idea will be a non-modifiable effect, and only that reminds you what you are. Everything else in this world does not remind you of what you are at all. Even the guru does not remind you of what you are. Okay, this is a point that's very important. Now, when people go to gurus and say, I love you, you're the greatest being in the world I've ever been, I surrender to you, all this stuff, they're missing the point. Now, the guru might just smile, etc. But they know very well that the appearance of the guru is not the answer, is not the reminder. Because the appearance is in this world, it's set in the context of this world, and everything in this world is being modified. So everything about the guru is seemingly being modified as well. They're aging, they're growing, they're speaking words, they're moving in spatial relationships, relationships are changing. There's a whole vast parade going on all around them, and they're part of that too. So they know very well that they themselves are not the reminder. They point to the reminder. They're a reminder of the reminder. They're a reminder of the means of remembrance. they themselves are not the true means of remembrance. Very important. And this is not blasphemous. This is true compassionate teaching. So it's true of Jesus, it's true of Buddha, it's true of all teachers that have ever been on this planet or ever will be, that those teachers are not themselves the way. To say that that teacher themselves is the way is idolatry. What they're saying is that they know the way, okay, and they are experiencing the way, and that they're attracting you to the way, but they themselves, the appearance that they have in this world is not the way. The way is that one must repent, which means to choose a new idea. Very simple. Jesus said that you must repent, or else you won't see the kingdom of heaven. Very true. You must decide to let go of the idea of trying to be prime creator and decide to pick up the idea of not trying to be prime creator. That is what repentance is called. And the effect of that idea of not trying to be prime creator is what I call the overlay, the seamless overlay of all other effects. And there's one effect that overlays all others. It's not modified in the slightest bit. It's not changed in any way, by any effect at all. It's not even changed by Ananda Maharshi or Jesus or Buddha or Ramana Maharshi. They can't change this effect at all. No one can. Even God can't change this effect, can't modify it. Because reality is set up so that ideas have their effects, inseparable. They cannot be changed. So this idea is an idea of non-modification, non-negation. Therefore, the effect of that idea will be effect that is non-modifiable. Nothing is changing in it. Nirvana means not moving. Nothing is moving. Nothing is changing. No changing spatial relationships within this effect. It's all one seamless effect. And Ananda Maharshi said the same thing as Jesus says. In order to truly experience God, one has to have the vision of oneness. No two ways about it. He said there's no other way, period. And Jesus said again, there's no other way. You must repent in order to see the kingdom of heaven. Same thing. You must choose a new idea, and automatically then you'll experience the effect of that idea. It's the idea of non-modification. That is the way to salvation. That is the way to solve all problems. All problems are solved. The problem of existence itself is solved, because existence is nothing but a forgetfulness of what we are. That is the problem of existence. And the only solution is remembrance of what we are. It's the only way to solve the problem of existence. So those who have chosen this, they know it all. They've solved the riddle of the problem of existence permanently. It's solved. And they convey that to us, but they themselves are not the solution. The overlay is the answer. Choosing a new idea is the answer. And again, the overlay, there's different terminologies that different words are used at. And some say, call it awareness, or perfect consciousness, or the self. Okay, look, that's all speaking of the same thing. Awareness is not our identity. Awareness is the overlay. And in other words, it's seamless. Everything arises in awareness, but awareness is itself is untouched by everything that arises. Okay. That's the actual overlay. What we really are is actually beyond that. What we truly are is spirit. And spirit experiences directly, not even through awareness. Okay. Perfect direct experiencing doesn't even need consciousness and awareness whatsoever. So when you hear consciousness, awareness, etc., that's the intermediate step. That's the overlay that I'm speaking about. That's what the effect that arises from choosing a new idea. The idea of not trying to be prime creator gives rise to this effect, this perfect superimposition, this perfect overlay, this seamless awareness, this seamless consciousness, this so-called self, this perfect flawless self. This seamless garment, this vision of oneness, this Christ consciousness, it's all referring to the same effect that arises from this idea of not trying to be prime creator. And it's that which should be our focus. At the level of ideas, choosing a new idea, our focus should not be on persons, which is idolatry. It should be on the message that they're sending. And Of course, we're going to have tendencies to idolatry a certain bit because we're so familiar with that. And we'll kind of mix it up. So some people who go to a teacher will, you know, fawn over them and say, oh, you're so wonderful. You're so perfect. I can't believe how what a great, wonderful being you are. I'm so in love with you and all this. And, you know, the teacher has to be able to just, you know, shed this like water off a duck's back and smile and be gracious about it. And then, you know, try to inculcate a spiritual work ethic that'll start pointing one towards the true answer. The true answer. The love that one is feeling towards a guru is really the love, the attraction of what one is feeling towards the overlay, towards pure awareness. That is actually the attraction. It's not the person, really. It's not really the person at all. Person is simply a walking corpse, like all bodies are. Bodies are simply walking corpses, corpse being animated. There's no real life in the body whatsoever. It's just a communication device at best. We don't have any real love for that, nor the personality, okay? We don't have any love for that either, not really. That's all temporary, it's modifications, all sorts of... The charisma of personalities is the ability to play relativeness off against itself. It's able to use duality in an amusing, clever way. That's personal charisma. Okay, and people love that too. People can personality can be very humorous, very funny, give us all sorts of laughter and tears and emotions and all these things. Great storytellers, all of this stuff. That's simply like playing a piano or something. You know, hear this delightful music. They know how to tickle the ivories, play the piano in a certain way. And that's, we like that. But it has really nothing to do with the true message whatsoever. And people can fall in love with this personality charisma. And then miss the greater prize, the great prize that the spiritual teacher is pointing to. So, to a certain extent, this has to be discouraged. Idolatry has to be discouraged. The world looks to the United States for leadership. And the United States is steeped in a cult of idolatry right now. Very bad, and going an avalanche in the wrong direction. And that's why I was hoping there would be a spiritual revival of someone who simply rejected that whole cult of idolatry and would bring people into silent meditation, silent experiencing, silent presence, and someone who is adept at pointing beyond themselves, their appearance. And unfortunately, that has not happened. In this world right now, I don't know anyone who is truly adept at pointing beyond their own appearance. Not to a profound extent. There is some adeptness to in the world here and there, but it's kind of feeble, to tell you the truth. And there are many spiritual teachers who are actually encouraging idolatry to a tremendous extent. They're pointing out all these spiritual powers you can get, all these kundalinis and shaktis and all these kinds of leelas and siddhas and powers, etc., that you can supposedly make, you know, learn to live an exquisite life here. Such nonsense, such idolatry, such a false path, really, that is. None of that is true. That is actually the way. You see, we have a profound attraction to truth, and the ego knows that. The ego is just a term for mind presenting this dance of forgetfulness. So the mind knows we have a profound, spirit has a profound attraction for what it is in truth, in reality. Spirit loves what it is, completely through and through, perfect love for what it is. So it's extremely difficult to get spirit to forget what it is. In fact, spirit cannot get rid of this attraction it feels for reality. So the mind has to accommodate this strong attraction to what spirit is. So mind has to give rise to lots and lots and lots of so-called spiritual teachers who seem to be leading us towards remembrance of who we are, but in fact, they are leading us on a wild goose chase. So the whole time we're thinking, yeah, I'm making progress, I'm getting close to remembering what I am. The fact is, we're simply being spun around in circles. I'm not really getting anywhere. And it's only when we realize we've been duped that we then get really serious and say, whoa, wait a minute, you know, wow. And start waking up and seeing the bigger picture of how clever the mind is. See, the mind cannot simply have an atheistic world. It's not possible. Because we have this innate, strong attraction to what we are, to remember what we are. So the ego somehow, again, has to accommodate that. Strongest of all drives is the strongest drive there is. It will try to deflect that in any way, and it deflects it towards idolatry. It says, worship this great being, and that will bring you closer to God. But what happens is this great being will simply throw up all sorts of obstacles for you, cause you to do all this work in vain, to make all sorts of music and artwork. I did all those things. I did so many things. I used every talent that I had. And suddenly I didn't even have, I developed new talents, all sorts of new talents. I just did everything. Things that I, you know, had never done before, and I was just completely inept at. I literally said, okay, I'm going to learn to be an expert at this, and became an expert at it, simply through tremendous determination and feeling that I was really doing a great service to the world. I literally, it was such a situation, I had one instance where I sat down and I said, I need to learn German. I didn't know a word of German, but I said, I need to learn it because it's going to be utilized and helpful. And so I went on a crash course, you know, just complete immersion in within a matter of several weeks, I was speaking German and was feeling like, you know, I was going to be able to get a grasp of the language. Eventually, within several months, probably. And then I realized the whole thing fell through, nothing came of it, and I stopped. And I've forgotten all of it. But it goes to show you that where there's a will and determination and a feeling that you are, this is vitally important to help humanity, to help all spirit here remember what it is, the capacity comes to extraordinary measures. I taught myself how to play innumerable instruments, just about every instrument you could imagine. I could teach myself to play. If someone brought up a new instrument, I said, I can learn how to play that. Give me a couple weeks, a couple months, and I will be able to play that instrument fairly well. And I did. I was able to record all sorts of music, playing all different instruments myself, composing, writing music, making posters, all sorts of graphic imagery, all multimedia videos. I had to teach myself to get up to speed in the entire technology of the times, marketing, scouting, publicity, every last facet. I had to teach myself all these things, like as if I was going to be kind of supervising the satsang. That was kind of my role, that I was shown that I was to be doing a sort of an overall coordinator and supervisor of the satsang. In other words, part of the sangha, one of the key members of the sangha. Now, if you have like a guru comes into the world and is teaching, you have a sangha, I mean, the support group that helps, you know, get the message out. And so I was trained to be the one of the head coordinators of this huge sangha that was going to occur when this great spiritual teacher made their advent into the world. Again, never happened. No teacher, no sangha, and no payback for incredible debt that I went into. So basically it turned me into a slave, an indentured servant, you know, with no hope in sight. And the promises I had were just endless. And every time the promise was unfulfilled, another promise came that kind of said, well, you've been bumped up a notch, you're going to get even greater reward, so don't worry about it. You know, it's that kind of thing. It's the intelligence of deception that the mind employs to help us forget what we are is very cunning. So you may think that you're smart enough to avoid it, but I tell you, nobody is. No one really is. because the deception could be approaches you in a way that you're vulnerable to it. And even though you see through it, you are then told that actually this was like a test to see, you know, you're being tested to see how loyal you are, and now you're actually giving a much higher position of responsibility because you passed this test. And so you hate at that point, you hate to say, now this whole thing is just a con job. You hate to see that, because then you feel like everything you've done is wasted and your life is ruined. And then you're turning down a much higher position. And you're told, you want to believe that, yeah, this was all just a test of to see how responsible you could be, and now you're being bumped up the corporate ladder. You see, the mind presented existence in a way during the 19th and 20th century as a vast corporate hierarchy, a vast hierarchy through theosophy, Madame Blavatsky, in general, a lot of information in the world, as did, what's her name? Alice Bailey, and these books were brought out as the great theosophical movement. And I was very schooled in that, just read all the books, was very, very schooled. And then Krishnamurti came around, and he was schooled to be the leader of theosophy and really be the Christ upon the earth. And what happened was Krishnamurti held a big conclave convention and got up there and told everybody, look, I'm quitting the role that you've given me. You all want to worship me. You all want to idolize me. You all want to place me at the top of this pyramid, hierarchical pyramid, this vast corporate ladder of spiritual attainment. You want to put me at the top. And he said, this is all imagination. It's all fantasy. It's all the ego. He said, so I'm renouncing all this. I'm giving it all up. I don't want to be part of this anymore. This is not truth. You're not teaching truth. And it stunned everyone. Now, of course, I came across the teachings of Krishnamurti very early in my life, and also theosophy, so I was schooled in both of them. And then the question is, which is true? Are there all these spiritual masters in this hierarchy? You know, if you know theosophy, you know what I'm talking about. That there was channel material, and they very plainly said that they're extraterrestrials, and they have a lodge on Sirius and throughout the cosmos, and they have this great brotherhood and sisterhood of spiritual adepts that is guiding the destiny of humanity and raising them up step by step, and that all of existence is this vast ladder of attainment, and you can go from greater to greater to greater to greater to greater awareness of the cosmos and how it functions. And there are even teachers in this planet right now who claim to be great adepts, or even the highest adept, who also talk about this, how you gradually expand in love and awareness and go that direction. Now, Krishnamurti rejected this entirely. Ramana Maharshi didn't say anything about that. Sri Nanmaima never said anything about that. Rejected her. Their teachings were very different. So what I've come to the standpoint of believing that the true teachings are the teachings of Ramana and Anandamayi, and A Course in Miracles, and Jiva Krishnamurti, that the vision of oneness frees you from the dream of forgetfulness entirely, and then you know what you are. And from that point, there's not a question of attainment at all. There's a quest, there's a simply an experience and a rich tapestry of greater and greater experiencing, but it's not attainment of any kind. Okay, so this whole corporate ladder that was presented to the world, took root in this world, and is the driving force behind the ideology of the planet right now. It's something that only a few people really are aware of. I'm profoundly aware of this. I've been observing this. The charter of the United Nations is actually based on theosophy. Okay, and the movers and the shakers on the planet, those who are really high up on this planet as far as intellectually concerned, basically believe in the corporate, spiritual corporate hierarchy of theosophy. And they believe that this is truth, and that the world is supposed to be lifted up bit by bit, incrementally, and that they're undergoing a divine plan. There's a divine plan for this planet, and they're part of helping that take place. And all these changes and modifications to the planet, which are, you know, we're experiencing an incredible rapidity, or the actual unfolding of this divine plan, that they are helping to anchor this plan here in the world, that the United Nations and all the laws that are being passed now, international laws, which every country is supposedly going to be bound by, which really creates a one world, new world order, one world order, centralized government, is actually the divine plan unfolding here on Earth, is actually, quote unquote, heaven on Earth, heaven arriving on Earth, manifesting on Earth. And that somehow this is the mandate that Jesus Christ brought here and told us about. And this is all the outworking of that. But if A Course in Miracles is to be believed, none of this is true. If these great gurus that actually came to this planet, like Sri Anandamayi Madhavamana Maharshi and Jiddu Krishnamurti, are to be believed, and I certainly do believe them because they walk the walk and they talk the talk and walk the walk here, then none of this is all just an egoic fantasy, okay, that helps us stay in a state of forgetfulness of what we are by accommodating our desire to remember what we are, but by leading us on a wild goose chase by saying, yeah, you can remember what you are. In fact, this is how you do it, as you climb this spiritual corporate ladder, bit by bit by bit, age after age after age, cycle after cycle after cycle, millennia after millennia, eon after eon, you gradually become more of what you are, remember what you are in this way. And so we're attracted to that. We believe, yeah, okay, we're doing what we're supposed to be doing. And this makes us feel like we are remembering what we are, but in point of fact, we're not. We're still enmeshed in complete forgetfulness of what we are. Severe, because all we're seeing is modification. Modification is what keeps us in forgetfulness of what we are. And the only cure is non-modification. And there's, as we look at the world here and all these plans that the United Nations are, all these laws that are being passed, these international laws, and every country is supposed to be signatory to these, and everyone's supposed to be bound by all this, those are severe modifications. Incredibly severe. Everything on this planet is a severe modification taking place constantly. Okay. I see a lot of interruptions coming up here. So that does not remind us of what we are. It keeps us in deep forgetfulness of what we are. It doesn't matter how altruistic, how compassionate, how forward-looking, how so-called divine plan-ish any of this is. It doesn't remind us of what we are. It does not. So these great teachers, these great gurus, they tell us, you know, they basically say, that is not the way. That is not the way. There are no political solutions to our problems. There are not even any spiritual solutions to our problems. There's only one solution to a problem, and that is experience the effect of non-modification. There's only one way. Jesus pointed out, there's only one way to the kingdom of heaven. Very narrow way. The gate is narrow, meaning there's no compromise. There's no two ways. You don't bring several ways along. There's only one way. But again, that one way is experiencing the overlay. It's actually choosing an idea of which the overlay is in the thought. And that's the only way to be saved. It is not the person of Jesus that's it, as many claim. Again, that is a distraction, a misdirection, an idolatry. It's experiencing the overlay that is the one and only cure. And again, some people use different terms for it. They may say, experience the perfect awareness. Same thing. Drop everything. Forget everything. Experience only this, the pure consciousness. Experience only the stillness. That's another term for the emptiness or the great spaciousness, perfect spaciousness. All terms for the same thing. It's the same effect that everyone is pointing to. And the teacher will say, drop everything, experience that. And the student will say, oh, how can I drop everything? I'm so in love with you, I don't want to drop you. Gotta drop the teacher too. Because the teacher is a constant play of modification in this world. But the teacher knows that their appearance in this world is not their identity. A mere appearance. That's what Anandamayi Mama said. She said, you all want this appearance, so now it appeared. She said, I didn't come here of my own volition. I came here because you wanted this appearance. Because I didn't. I'm not responsible for this appearance whatsoever. And what this appearance does or where it goes, in other words, all the modifications, is coming from you, from us, not from her. She goes, what I am has never been modified and will never be modified. I am exactly the same as I've always been, even though the dance of existence dances continuously throughout the eons. Doesn't affect or modify what I am one bit. So her appearance was because we, the world, wanted it, that appearance to take place. Now, I thought that the present world also wants an appearance to take place that will help us. That's what I was going on. But apparently, the world does not want that. The world wants something to idolize. Okay, so there may be an appearance. I call the goddess of destructivity, who is actually on this planet right now. And she may come out at some point, and the world will idolize her. There's no question about it. And we have been prepared for this by political, social, entertainment figures, cultural figures of all types. We've been prepared to idolize a potential figure, the so-called Messiah. This Messiah is a deceiver. Okay, it's the Antichrist. We've been prepared to welcome the Antichrist here, and I guarantee you that if such a figure arises in this world, a great majority of the world will idolize them and will persecute those who do not, saying somehow that they are anti the divine plan that is supposed to be working out here, because the world has been set up to believe in this corporate spiritual hierarchy, and to believe that at the top of this hierarchy will come down into this world and lift the whole planet up into this golden age. Okay, but that is the ego's teaching. That's the mind's mystery. It's the mind's deception. It's how the mind keeps us, spirit forgets, by having to accommodate our deep attraction. But to misdirect that attraction onto this plan of delay is what it really is. This whole idea of gradual, incremental lifting of the planet and vibration, etc., is a plan, that's a delay, plan of delay. That's the ego's plan. The teacher, the real teacher, will tell you right now, drop everything, forget everything, jump into the unknown. Now, some can say that, who have mastered that rhetoric, who themselves may want to be idolized. Okay, that is a very distinct possibility, and probably in some cases it's actually true. I'm not going to go get into spiritual politics of names, etc. But it's something that one we have to be aware of. Yes, the right advice is to drop everything and just jump into the unknown, what can never be known by the mind, etc., etc., all that. That is the rhetoric of non-dual rhetoric and enlightened rhetoric, and it's very true. It's very right advice. But some can, again, be giving this advice out and yet steering those towards idolatry. Excuse me. Towards idolatry.
I am.
So, ultimately, what we must do is we must jump. Get a drink of water here, excuse me. What we do must do is we must jump. We must forget everything, drop everything. Realize that existence is futile. Forgetfulness is futile. It doesn't lead to anything. Forgetfulness of what we are does not lead to anything except suffering. No matter what kind of glamorous being we have fronting for it, no matter what kind of Messiah we're following, that Messiah will not lead us to anything but more suffering. Okay? Because again, we're only experiencing that which cannot be modified, frees us from forgetfulness of what we are. And forgetfulness of what we are is suffering. No way to be forgetful of what we are and not suffer. No way, okay? No way to do that. You can have the most glamorous, charismatic Messiah possible, and that glamorous charismatic Messiah cannot give anyone away to not suffer, to have forgetfulness of what we are and still not suffer. Impossible. The real Messiah is the one that says, I am not the Messiah. The real Messiah is the one who abides in non-modification and pure awareness, pure stillness and pure emptiness and pure spaciousness and pure peace and pure quietude and pure presence of non-modification, and then says, look, I am not the Messiah. Your choice is your Messiah. You're choosing to experience this is your Messiah. Your capacity to choose a new idea is the Messiah. And that Messiah is inherent within you. It was given, you were created that way by God the Prime Creator, and you cannot modify what God the Prime Creator created. Therefore, all you need to do is exercise your will to do this, and you will experience the true Messiah, the true miracle, which is this overlay. The pure awareness, the pure spaciousness, the pure stillness, the pure peace, the vision of Christ, the vision of oneness, nirvana, samadhi, Christ consciousness, peace beyond understanding, seamless garment, all terms for the exact same effect. Just experience that. Again, that is another term for it, that. Just experience that. And you will realize that that overlays all of appearances, including the appearances of all the gurus and saints and sages and saviors and avatars and pundits and prophets and everything, etc., etc., etc. It overlays all. And idolaters reject that. And they say, no, there's one exception. The one that we idolize is greater than the overlay. The one we idolize is God. That's what they say. That's what idolaters say. No one who is oriented towards truth is going to say that the one that is being idolized is God. Only God is God. God, the Prime Creator, is greater than what is created. It's one essence. It's a seamless oneness. But the origin of that is greater than that which is being expressed and expanded and shared. In other words, reality goes in one direction, not two. So there's no way that any appearance can appear in this world with appearance and be God. It's not possible. God is beyond all appearances. God is within all appearances, equally within all. God is greater than all those appearances, all those ideas, all those expressions, all that experiencing. God, the Prime Creator, is greater than that. It's primary. The extension is secondary. The extender, that which does the extending, is primary. So the teachers, the gurus that come in here and say, you know, the right thing is that all is God. I see only one. I see only God. That is their witnessing. There's their testimony. But they are not saying that they are the Prime Creator. They say they're experiencing the Prime Creator. That's a difference. They are one with the Prime Creator. Of course, ideas cannot leave the origin. It's impossible. So God, the Prime Creator, extends through ideas. But those ideas are still within the mind of God. They're one with God. There's no separation. But those ideas are not primary. They're the extension. But they're not the one that is doing the extending. They did not set reality the way that it is. So the real teacher, the real guru, is the one that gives you this feeling, this particular feeling. It's a profound feeling they know that their appearance is merely a useful symbol of attraction towards that which is beyond all appearances. And they have zero attachment to their own the historic nature whatsoever. You might call them completely non-historic. Ananda Maima had zero interest in it, in her historic legacy. Zero. None. No interest in promoting herself. None. And you get that feeling. That's the feeling I got very clear. That this being, this presence here is merely here for our benefit, for those who want to be reminded of the remedy. And she said, if we did not have any need for her here, her body would lie in a heap on the floor, completely unmoving like a sack of rags. She said, that's literally true. And when there were times when people tended to be turned away from her and put their attention on politics and the world, etc., she would sit in a corner, inert, like she was dead, like a heap of rags, and not unmoving. And sometimes it would take days to get her out of that condition, and people would have to chant and sing songs and turn their attention, saying, hey, we want you to help remind us of truth. And then she would reanimate and function that way. But she said that her functionality here was entirely directed by the desires of people here in this world for spiritual truth. And if they had no desire, the body again would be inert. And time and time again, it would become completely inert, and she'd go into some sort of extremely withdrawn state, very high samadhi, the bliss beyond bliss, so to speak, the great bliss, and the body would seem to be dead, non-functional, icy cold. And it was very difficult to get her out of that condition and get her back talking and moving around and functioning again, because, as she said, she had no purpose or desire to come here at all. That's true witnessing. There's no spiritual ego there. None. Zero. Which is frustrating for us, because in this idolatrous world, we feel like you gotta sell it somehow, you know. And she didn't want to sell it, had no desire to sell it at all. So my viewpoint, I figured, you know, in this present day and age where we are smitten with such incredible idolatry, we don't have any idea of how deep we're in it. Hollywood has been the great idol factory, churning out the lessons in idolatry. Really, when you watch television, you're getting severe lessons in idolatry. That's why it's so distasteful for me to watch television. I feel extremely smeared, you know, and distasteful, as if I'm been just, you know, something very odious has been thrown on me, slime, just horrible, because idolatry, horrible, hardcore idolatry is being practiced in this whole world now. We're practicing idolaters. That's not religion, that's not spirituality. It's the opposite of it. And those who come to teach now in this world is, you know, the interest is so minimal. And in some ways, they may try to spice it up and to help attract a following, to have to, you know, somehow adapt to some degree of idolatry, or put up with it. Put up with it. You know, I see a lot of idolatry being put up with. And there's very little severe teaching going on. I don't see, in fact, to tell you the truth, I don't see any. Maybe there's a little bit here and there where you just simply, you know, like, these are the rules. This is what the purpose is. And I guess there are some traditions. But by and large, you know, it's vanishing. The overall mood of the world is, you know, absolutely geared. It's like people are gearing themselves for idolatry. And literally, this is true. So I expect that some messiah, false messiah, will arise in this world. Because the world is expecting it. The world is demanding it. They're demanding an idol. They're demanding a great idol. You know, maybe this idol would be very charismatic, be able to sing beautifully, be able to talk beautifully, great orator, a great singer, someone who's can pour out spiritual platitudes beautifully, talk the talk of unification, of advancement, of lifting the planet up, raising the vibration of the planet and bringing it to a higher dimension, feeding the poor, distributing everything equitably around the world, so no more starvation, like illness and starvation, all this stuff. That's what the Antichrist will focus on, will talk like that. And some people have immunity to it. Like, I feel I will certainly have immunity to that. See through it, you know, in 2 seconds. Because none of that is true teaching. The idea of raising the planet's vibration, that's not true teaching. Lifting humanity up, that's not true teaching. That's the way. It seems like we're doing people a service by that, but we're not. Nanda Mahima said that God removes suffering by suffering. In other words, uses the misery and suffering of existence to turn us to truth. So you wonder why didn't she, you know, do all this charitable stuff? She said, that's not it. That literally you're suffering. You must look at your suffering in the right light and take it that God has put, quote unquote, put that there, even though that's not actually true. But put it there in order to spur you on towards getting free of suffering. Spur you on to choosing a new idea. Spur you on to decide to remember what you are instead of forget what you are. And that's the proper way to take existence. All this misery and suffering, she says, don't try and change it. Let it be. Let it be the way that it is. Let this inequality and misery and suffering, let it be that way. Another interesting teacher in Carlos Castaneda books, Don Juan. I don't know who Don Juan is, whether it was a literary fiction or a real teacher or what. But there was some very interesting things Don Juan said, and one of them was, he said, actually your spiritual truth, your salvation is greatly helped by living in a country that's in a petty tyranny, petty dictatorship. Actually, it's very helpful. But the suffering, the misery, the fear, the difficulties, all of that actually strengthens one's resolve to get free of it all. And when you try and make the world a utopia, a paradise, you're actually doing a disservice. You're actually delaying the true awakening, the true remembrance that must take place. Because if one says, hey, this world's a really pretty nice place. I mean, I've got this, there's this Messiah who's come to the world, and they're saying they're going to fix everything, they're going to cure. I mean, I expect an economic crash to happen, and then the Messiah to show up. And this Messiah will say, hey, I can fix all of this. It's very easy. Just follow these simple prescription. You know, follow, everyone be bound by these laws, everyone cooperate, let's everyone get on the same page, and we'll turn this world into a utopia. That's actually retarding our genuine spiritual progress severely, because we'll say, hey, this world is not so bad. You know, we're heading in a great direction. We're wiping out illness. We've got all these treatments now, and we're not going to be sick. We're not going to age so badly. The infirmities of aging won't be so bad. We're going to live longer. We're not going to see so much crime and suffering and starvation around the world. It's horrible. We're not going to have all these wars. You know, this world is going to be a peaceful planet. We're going to be allowed to join the Confederation, the Galactic Federation of Planets, which Theosophy talks about, that there's a confederacy, a federation of advanced planets, and supposedly the divine plan is to raise this Earth up high enough vibration so that it can be accepted into this Confederation of Planets. When we're accepted into that, then we're going to get all these tremendous benefits of spiritual technology, which will turn this planet into a paradise. That's the story. That's what the world believes. That's what the direction of the intelligentsia of this planet, that's the direction they're going. That's what they've been schooled in. Guarantee this is true. Because I one time was a very high intelligentsia. I was not part of it, but I had this. I was on the same level. I could easily understand everything that they were talking about. And then I saw beyond that. I said, wow, this may not be the right way. There's severe flaws in this entire situation. I was able to read, you know, the theosophy at an early age, everything at an early age, and understand it. Had the capability to organize my mind, to focus in and hold a panoramic picture. But in doing so, I was able then to go beyond that and see that there is actually a way that actually works. And whereas this way, it works to keep us in forgetfulness. So there is a feeling of it's working, okay? Lifting the planet up, building a paradise, being allowed to join a great confederation of cosmic, or cosmic federation of other planets, and meeting extraterrestrials, and learning telepathy and spiritual powers, and learning group action, and all those things. It sounds so great. It sounds like we are getting something very profound. We're succeeding. We're making progress. Yeah. There's a feeling of success, okay, and all of that. But what this success really is we're succeeding in remaining in forgetfulness of what we are, which is the whole purpose of mind's, this whole scenario of existence. The only purpose it is to keep us in forgetfulness of what we are, so that we can plausibly believe that we are prime, that we can become prime creator, or that we are prime creator. That's all it is. So of course, as we continue our forgetfulness of what we are, finding ways to accommodate our desire to remember what we are, but actually not remembering what we are, we feel we are succeeding. We feel we are having profound success, and that very soon we will all experience the ultimate payoff of this great success, except that this ultimate payoff never comes. Even the great spiritual masters in theosophy say that they still are advancing and evolving, and that they have not finished, and there's endless vistas ahead of them. Meaning, and they also talk about how things go wrong, and how they're surprised by various things, and they don't really understand it all, and all this kind of stuff. You never heard Ananda Maima talk like that. She'd say very plainly, it's just, I see only the one, there's only the one. There's only God. And I see it perfectly, every second. It's impossible I ever see anything other than that. That's an absolute statement. There is no gradualism there. There's no corporate hierarchy there. There's no talk of a divine plan there. She said the divine plan is new suffering. Suffering on this world is a thorn in our side. She told people to live an austere life. Don't indulge in the comforts of this world, she said. You know, sleep on a hard bed, you know, don't eat a lot, get up early, don't get a lot of sleep, you know, be miserable, and use that misery to fire your determination, to choose a new idea, to experience the vision of oneness. And I believe that is the accurate teaching, and the teachings of this world are false. That's ego mind, teaching of this world, ego mind, telling you, oh, sure, you can remember what you are, and here's this long, circuitous path to do it. And you have to tread this vast, long path and make all these modifications. As you do so, you also have to take everyone along with you. Raise everybody else up, too. It's all done as a group endeavor. Very curious, this teaching. Very curious indeed. So, what I have seen is that there will be a crash, economic crash. Now, whether that was put there by the deceivers or it was a genuine vision is something that is yet to be determined. I certainly believe it was a genuine vision, because everything I was shown in that vision has come true. But remember that the psychic entities, they can foresee the future also. So they can tell you accurately what's going to take place, but then can also put in a false conclusion to it. They're capable of that. So I cannot say I'm 100% certain that there will be an economic crash, because I still have to leave the door open to possibility that I can be misled, because I don't have a vision of oneness, which means I can't be misled, which means I still have some trace of belief and compromise and delay, and that can be exploited. Anyone who doesn't have the vision of oneness can be exploited and misled. And everyone, without exception. Without exception. So that's why don't rest on your laurels at all. You must continue to find the highest teaching possible and keep trying to accept it. And again, drop everything. Enough is enough. You don't need to spend one more moment considering anything. Just drop everything and experience the pure awareness, the overlay, the perfect superimposition, the seamless peace beyond understanding. Just experience that. That is, you know, ultimate teaching. Just do it. And of course, when we don't do it, then we say, why didn't we do it? And my teaching is designed to help one see why they don't do it. And by seeing it, the reluctance is overcome. There's something about continuously only teaching, just do it, just do it, just jump. That to me, it's great teaching if you're ready to jump. But if you're not ready to jump, it's good teaching, but it also needs the support system of, I believe, of the kind of teaching that I'm giving, which gives a wider perspective, gives a total perspective to the whole situation of why did the situation arise in the first place? Why do you need to jump? Why did forgetfulness of OPR arise? You know, and then what is the true remedy, and what is the whole picture from all the way to the very, very root of the situation? Whereas the teachers just say jump, they say forget about all that, just jump. And of course, very few jump. They themselves complain about it. They say, I taught my whole life, and my whole life maybe just one or two jump. No one else did. Well, that's because people did not have a wide enough perspective on it. And so the reluctance was too strong. So what I have done is I've taken a close look at the entire situation, found out where the reluctance is, where is it coming from, the tricks of the ego, how the mind tricks us and causes fear in us, how the mind tries to give us false direction and spiritual attainment of spiritual capacities and powers, etc. How the mind tells us the Messiah is coming and we're supposed to wait for that. All these various things are so many. Those cause us to wait and delay. We say, well, I'm almost ready to jump, but not yet. There's a saying in Christianity, say, Jesus, return. I want you to return, but not yet, not today. There's so many other sinners I have to reach. Don't come yet, don't come yet. The same all over. Any tradition, it's, yeah, I want to do a jump, but not right now. I just want to wait one more day. And you will find out that one more day ends up spending a whole lifetime. So the teachers say, just jump. Forget everything, drop everything, just do it, just jump. You know? That is, I feel it is, it needs support. It needs a richer context, deeper context, which is what I am doing, what I've done in these videos, laid out this rich context of the entire situation for you, so that you will be literally able to one day jump, just drop everything, drop the whole dance of existence, saying it's got nothing for me, it never had anything for me, and enough is enough, enough of this foolishness, nothing but foolishness, that's all it is, even though all this stuff about one day you're going to become a great bodhisattva, a great this and a great that, drop all that. Even drop it, one day you're going to become a great Buddha, drop it. It's nothing. One day you're going to be heading the sangha of a great satsang, drop that. It's nothing. One day you're going to be at the feet of a great teacher, drop that. It's nothing. So in hearing this, it might be shocking, and maybe some people take exception to it, but really there's no other remedy. Maybe they're not ready to hear it. There is no other remedy. Eventually, one has to hear this. In the 60s, we had this saying, hey, you see the Buddha on the road, kill the Buddha. You see the Buddha on the path, kill the Buddha. They don't mean literally kill the Buddha. They mean forget about the Buddha. Drop the Buddha. Just a thought form. Just the ego. And there are teachers who teach this way, but the success is very, very limited. Very limited, because the roots of the ego are so deep, we don't realize how deep they are. And so when we cannot drop everything and just experience the overlay, what happens is people then fall into idolatry of the teacher. And they say, oh, I'm just not loving the teacher enough. I just worship the teacher. Somehow the teacher convey upon me the capacity. Maybe the teacher has this capacity, but they're not doing it for me because I'm not doing enough for the teacher. So I need to do better service, better seva, better service for the teacher. I need to build my life around the teacher. I need to spend my every waking moment thinking of the teacher, loving the teacher. I need to do whatever the teacher asks me to do. I need to be the slave to the teacher. I need to worship the teacher. You know? And then they're thinking eventually the teacher will somehow convey upon them the capacity to jump. But what I have found is the capacity to jump comes from tremendous spiritual work ethic to clarify. That's what Nandamayama taught. So get to work. And then you say, I'm doing a lot, do more. Spending, you know, 5 hours in contemplation, just make it 10. Like that. That is the right teaching. You say, don't sit around worshiping me. Spend 10 hours in contemplation every day. Get up every day. Do it every day. Don't miss a day. Don't ever miss a day. Take it like if your life depends upon it. Don't ever miss out. It's your duty. That is the kind of teaching, I believe, that ultimately succeeds, you know, in a wide way. Of course, those who say just jump, they will succeed. Some will jump, of course, because they're ready. Why? Because they've already done the work. But that doesn't mean that it will be a wide-based success ultimately. The only way that the world, quote-unquote, the world will be saved is for the world to engage in tremendous spiritual discipline. To live a very ascetic lives, very frugal ascetic lives devoted to spiritual discipline. It's the only way. And the fact is that as we look at this world right now, you know, we may think the young generation has it great because they have all the influence and the power and the technology, and they seem to be, the world is their oyster, you know. But the fact is that there are so many problems in the world that they will be overwhelmed by trying to solve these problems. And in attempting to solve these problems of the world, thinking that's the right thing to do, they will literally avoid the spiritual efforts they need to do. They will neglect it. That is the great danger that the younger generations are in. Great, severe danger, because the amount of service to the world that will seem necessary just to survive here. You know, the problems are overwhelming, to tell you the truth, coming up in the world. Unbelievable problems. They will be completely enmeshed in it if they take that route of thinking the world service is the answer. So they will never, ever spend the right amount of time and effort on spiritual, on true spiritual discipline of clarification. They'll be too busy trying to solve the problems of the world. So it's a devastating thing. It's a devastating combination, because the idea that somehow the technology is that somehow that we have the tools to do the necessary work, but the necessary work is going to be fast and all-encompassing and will consume everyone's life here, try and get past the troubles of the times, which are overwhelming, really. Climate change is just one of them. The world's oceans dying, overfishing, the non-renewable resources, peak oil, entire financial and economic system, the overpopulation, the depletion of the world's resources, destruction of the world's atmosphere, and the imbalance of the planet. It goes on and on and on and on and on. And in order to try to solve those problems, it would be like a worldwide tyranny, which in itself is a drastic problem. And so, if one spends one's time working on those problems, where is there any time left for appropriate spiritual discipline? Can one spend 5 hours in contemplation every day, 10 hours in contemplation every day? I used to spend 16, 18, 20 hours every day in contemplation of spiritual truth. Of course, I wasn't doing anything to solve the problems of the world, but actually what I was doing was solving the problems of existence, which is to remember the way of remembrance, which is to remember that the way of remembrance is to choose a new idea, which was to remember that by choosing a new idea, the effect of that idea is the effect of non-modification, provided that that idea is the idea of not trying to be prime creator. Get this overlay. I remember that. So I spent my time remembering the way of remembrance of what we are, which is the only way to solve the problems of existence. So if one spends the time trying to solve problems of the world in another way, it's futile. You'll simply continue to be led on a wild goose chase. The mind already has it all planned out as a blueprint to keep you chasing after remedies, false remedies that don't work, to keep you solving problems. Just the pollution problem of this planet is overwhelming, isn't it? The food problem. Every problem. You got a vast platter, a smorgasbord, a buffet of drastic problems here. And I know that people are being trained in education to think it's their duty to tackle these problems. I tell you, I may be the only voice you hear that's saying the opposite of this. It is absolutely not your duty. Only the ego will tell you it's your duty. Your duty is spiritual contemplation and clarification, and to do that every day, and to do your utmost, spend the utmost amount of time doing this. And you're not neglecting solving the world's problems by doing that. You're literally reminding the world of the way that the problems, only way the problems can be solved, which is to choose a new idea and experience, abide in the effect of that idea, experience that affects that idea. Abide in it, meaning don't choose the idea of not trying to be prime creator, and after a moment of experiencing this non-modification, to then jump back and choose the idea of trying to be prime creator and experience all the effects of forgetfulness, of basically dance of modification. Don't go back and forth. Abide in it means choose the idea of not trying to be prime creator. Experience this seamless peace, spaciousness, emptiness, stillness, quietness, oneness. Experience that continuously. Abide in that. Don't flip-flop and then say, okay, I've experienced it enough to get my feeling, just I feel tremendous peace, and now I'm going to choose the idea of being prime creator and see all this, experience all this modification, and now go to work on this modification and try to make it better so it doesn't harm people so badly. That's not what one is supposed to do. That is folly. That leads one down a very bad path. It leads one down the path of the Antichrist, a false messiah who may have a glimpse of truth, but then uses that to motivate them to try and become some superstar gurus, teacher, messiah, that the world will look to and idolize. It's kind of like, you know, the king of nothing, queen of nothing, or the queen of nothing. Everyone idolizes and say, you're the queen of forgetfulness, huh? We'll worship you instead of God. You know, that's what it is. Idolatry is basically providing a substitute of worship. Instead of worshiping God, worshiping his idols. God does not ask us to worship God even. Worship is our own idea. It's an egoic idea. God asks us to experience reality, experience our functionality the way we are created. That's what we're supposed to do. experience the perfection of reality, perfection of spirit and truth, the non-modifiable nature of reality, experience it. That's all God wants for us. Now, it's not saying spend all your time worshiping God. No. That's idolatry. We instead of functioning the way we were created to function, we instead say, oh, we're doing something far better, God, we're worshiping you. And God must say, ah, nonsense. Nonsense, nonsense. That's the ego. You see, that's a perfect example of the ego. We say, oh God, you want us to just function the way we were created, but we have something even better. We'll spend our time worshiping you. And we know that you'll enjoy that even more than having just us function the way he created us, as if somehow we know better than what God really wants. That's the ego. That's the attempt to be prime creator, right there. Saying, no, God, instead of functioning the way you created us, we're going to transcend that and do something even greater than that, because we came up with this idea that's even greater than that, and we're going to now worship you. God will shake his head, so to speak, and laugh and say, what nonsense, what nonsense, what foolishness. And in order to pursue this foolishness, we would look for idols to worship. We said, we need somebody that like God that we can worship here, so we can practice worshiping God. We can say, God, look, we're practicing worshiping you, and one day we'll worship you perfectly, and then you'll realize, God, that that's what you really wanted. It's better than just having us function the way you created us. Perfect example of folly, of idolatry. So the world looks for a Messiah that it can worship, that it can call God. The world even called Jesus God, said, no, Jesus, you're God. Even though Jesus repeatedly said, I am not God. I am one with God. I am the Son of God, but God is greater. Over and over again, he says, God is greater. And yet people insisted, no, you're God. Why? Because they want to worship something. They want to have their idea of what God wants imposed upon God, the prime creator. And so they can say, no, God, the prime creator, what you really want, you don't know it, but eventually you will know it, that worshiping you is what you really want. So that's what we're doing here. And we know you sent your son to this world to be worshiped because that's what you really want. And God is saying, no, that's not it at all. I sent my son here. I set the remembrance of my son, of the sonship here, to remind you of the one way of remembrance. That's what I want. I want you to remember what you are, so that then you can function, once again, function the way I created you to function, in the fullness of functionality. It's not that you've lost your functionality, you're just not using it. It's lying idle. God did not create spirit to lie idle in its functionality. We're functioning in a way, but it's a way of attempting to not function the way we were created. And provide a substitute for is if we're prime creator and we can dictate to God what God wants for us. We can say, no, God, you want for us to worship you. So you sent your only son into this world to be worshipped as God. That's the ego. It's idolatry. Okay, so that's speaking plain truth. I know there are a lot of people here like gagging right now. They don't say that. I can't stand hearing that. No, it's not true. We gotta learn how to worship God. That's what God wants. Not true. Everything I said in this video and all other videos, you should have a panoramic picture of a big picture that we tried to be prime creator, and we're trying to act like prime creator and tell God what God wants and dictate to God, say, no, God, this is what you want. This is the purpose that you sent Jesus in the world for. This is the purpose that you sent reminders of truth in the world for, to be worshipped, so we can practice worshiping you. And in fact, we'll call them God, and then in the worshiping of them, we'll say we are worshiping God, and therefore we don't need to do anything more. We don't need to remember what we are, because we've transcended what we are. We've transcended the purpose of what you created us for, God. That's what we're saying to God. We've changed the purpose of what you created us for. We've made it better. And now we're spending our time not in remembrance of what we are, but in worshiping you. You see how tricky that is? It's 100% ego. 100% ego. Probably the first time you ever heard this directly, and I say it's stressful for me, of course, because idolaters hate being pointed out that they're practicing idolatry, because they get used to laziness, gotten used to a false path, gotten used to believing that they're by doing this they're greater than God, right? And so it seems like I'm talking about a demotion here. Like I'm telling them that they should be demoted to something less. And then, of course, they think that God is really secretly furious with them about arrogating this new thing, and that God isn't used to it yet. You got to give God time to get used to this worshiping of God. You know, that's really what's going on. They say, no, we can't experience God yet, because God isn't used to this new way of being that we've imposed upon God. That instead of functioning as we are created to function, now we're functioning a different way, and God isn't used to that yet, so God is still cranky about it. So we need to give God time to get used to this. So that's how we're delaying, isn't it? We're saying we're giving God time to get used to us. That's literally what the ego is saying. Nobody wants to say this directly, but it's just being said right now. This is literally what's going on here. Oh no, we don't. What do you mean we're delaying? We're not delaying. We're already the way we are. We're worshiping God, and that's what we are about. It's God that we have to give time. God's the one that's delaying. God is the one that needs time. The practitioner needs time to get used to this new spirit, this new functionality of spirit that we're employing here. And God is really angry at us. He has to get over that anger. He needs anger management. And so we're giving him plenty of time, but we don't need to do anything. Just stay as we are. Just enjoy this world. This is our new home. This is what we're going to improve it and make it better. And God will get used to that. That's literally what's going on here. To be, very direct and open and clear about it. And it's kind of humorous to look at it this way. That's literally what's going on. We are trying to impose our will on God, the Prime Creator, and say, this is what you must accept. We have changed. We are now functioning a different way than you created us, and you must get used to it. And they're trying to say, come on, hurry up, we're tired of waiting. It's funny stuff, but very true stuff, very true. And when you see through it, you feel a kind of relaxation. You say, oh my gosh, how silly it all is, but it's great to be able to see it at its very stark, clear format, you see, seeing it as it is. We're trying to impose upon God the way God has to be, and telling him that we've changed, we found a way to change what we are, and tough love, we're practicing tough love on God. Gotta get used to that. We're never going back the way we used to be. You gotta get used to that. You gotta love us the way we are now. Tell you this, it's never gonna happen. We didn't change ourselves. We didn't change what we are at all. This is only a pretense. Egoic pretense is called spiritual pride. That's the original sin. That is the sin, the great sin, spiritual pride. That's what spiritual pride is. Dictating to God, the terms of the way reality is now. These are the new terms of reality. Get used to them. And of course, we're very accommodating. Say, hey God, we're even worshiping you. Look at this, it's really fun. Jump into this, because you'll be worshipped here. God is not fooled by this. God is not tricked by this one bit. Holy Spirit is not tricked by it one bit. The real teachers, the real guru is not tricked by this one bit. We can't change what we are. We remain as we were created. God does not ask us to worship the Prime Creator, but rather to function as we were created. In the fullness of how we are created, the full functionality to exercise that. Because that is what God wants. That's the expansion, the extension of God and all that is in reality. That is the great bliss. That is the great freedom. That is the great rich tapestry of experience. And you can see that the folly of what we've done, and we see it clearly, it's not so formidable, is it? But when we don't see it clearly, it seems incredibly formidable and difficult. When we see it clearly, you say, how silly. And it's very simple. We're trying to tell God the way reality is, trying to dictate the terms. We say, we've changed it, we're in charge now. You have to get used to it. Okay, if we see it just that way, anger won't arise in us. hatred won't arise in us. Guilt won't arise in us. We won't make guilt trips on people, say, you're wicked, you're bad, blah, 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 blah. We'll kind of have a chuckle at it. We'll say, oh my gosh, what a crazy thing we're trying to do here. Dictating terms to the prime creator. That is spiritual pride. And it's a great freedom in seeing this. I'm seeing it very clearly. I don't feel bad about myself. I don't feel terrible. I don't feel anything negative. It's all positive. So, aha, finally peeling back the layers and seeing, you know, what we've done. And I'm sure God is rejoicing right now. Saying, yes, 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 yes. Thank you, thank you, thank you. That's it, that's it, that's it. That's great. Very great. Exactly that, just that. It's said, you know, in the Gospels that God rejoices when a sinner returns home. Very true. Welcome home, welcome home, welcome home. Meaning, well said. Welcome back to your true functionality. I'm so, so pleased that you're able now to function as I created you. And you've given up trying to change the way your functionality and dictate to me the way my functionality too, because it's all folly. You can't do it. It's a waste of time. It's a journey to nowhere. It's a journey of futility. It's an attempt to accomplish the impossible. And you don't have to do that anymore. You're free of that. So God rejoices in that. There's rejoicing when the sinner returns home. Great rejoicing. And so just by hearing this, there's rejoicing going on in reality. Because you're saying, yeah, you're considering this. Consideration of this teaching is clarification. Heaven is reality is there and is saying yes. Eager, you know, for your clarification to deepen. God does want us to clarify and to return back home. Absolutely. God does want us to function the way we were created to function in the fullness of it. Again, it's inert. It's lying idle. It's still there. It's like a car in the driveway. It's not being driven. You know, a car is still perfectly capable of being driven. It's just not being driven. And so God does want us to drive that car to function the way we were created to function. Absolutely. But God knows that we have the freedom to keep that car idle if we want to. God cannot force that point upon us. But certainly God can send us reminders. As this great guru, Srila Nanamaya, was a perfect reminder, flawless reminder. A lot of people didn't pay attention. A lot of people rejected it. So a lot of people tried to, you know, make an idol out of it. And as again I've said, there are those who tried to imitate her and mislead by doing that. You know, and that continues on because that's spiritual pride. Those who do that say, no, God, you come into this world. We'll make it all perfect for you, but you come into this world. And you be worshipped here, because that's how we want to play things now. We want to decide what is home. We want to decide what the conditions of home are. We want to decide the parameters of reality. We want to decide how we function. We want to decide how you fit into our functionality. We've decided all this anew. We're the prime creators now, you see? You see that? How idolatry fits into all of that. This is the big picture that's being painted right now. Broad strokes. Like I said, this is what reality supports. This type of teaching, this type of witnessing. This is not the ultimate witnessing, as I've said before. It's a profound witnessing. But the greater witnessing is those who are simply abide in the state of non-modification, the effect of non-modification. Because that tells you, hey, it's really doable. It's 100% doable. Those are the high the touchstones, like Sri Anandamayama and others. So, I think the mosquitoes are probably sensing my presence here. So, I better bring this to an end, but I tell you, this has been a great, great, great satsang for me, sharing this information with you. which I know some will just absolutely freak out about and say is completely blasphemous, because in the world of idolaters, truth is very blasphemous. They say, it's so iconoclastic, you know, you're tearing down this idolatry, how horrible, how terrible, how dare you, you know, all this kind of stuff. So of course, it's not easy to be able to do this. The fact that I'm able to do this, you know, is really a wonderful thing. I feel blessed to be able to share this with the world, and for those of you who are watching this and hearing this, you get the sound of freedom. You get the faint scent of freedom, like an echo, like a musical tune. You're hearing this song, faint echo of this song, and you hear it and you say, I love that song. I want to hear it better. I want to hear it better. That's where we're going. That's where we're headed. And so thank God for all the touchstones of remembrance that have been sent into this world, no matter how they're used and abused and twisted into idols, etc. God keeps sending them because God knows that we need remembrance of what we are. We need to choose the one way, choose a new idea of not trying to be prime creator, which automatically gives rise to a non-modifiable effect. And experiencing that, abiding in that, is the perfect reminder of what we are. It reminds us of what we are, which is spirit, and which is non-modifiable. And then once we have perfect remembrance of that, then we can once again fully function as we were created by God, the prime creator, and all will be absolutely